Hello, welcome to Book Drop. My name is Viktor Valgarðsson, and with me is Andreas Schäfer from the University of Humboldt in Berlin. He's a postdoc. We are both visiting the University of Canberra, and I'm here for 3 months, and Andreas is for a month, and we are here to discuss his book. And I tried to pronounce the name, the title, but my German is too bad. So Andreas, can you tell me the name of your book?
Yeah,
what's it about?
It's unfortunately not in English, but in German. The title is Zwischen Repräsentation und Diskurs. So in English it would be Between Representation and Discourse. And it's on the role of deliberation and parliamentary decision making.
Mm-hmm.
So it's in German, but there's also a English article that summarizes at least the basic theoretical argument in the Australian Journal of Political Science.
Okay, very good. So, what do you find? What is the role of representation and discourse in?
So, first of all, I started from the rather interesting observation that there is a kind of tension in the parliament that is puzzling somehow in terms of deliberation.
Yeah.
So on the one hand, you have procedures,
mm-hmm.
Institutions, settings in the parliament that kind of demand that deliberation takes place.
Yeah.
So decisions can't just be taken right from the beginning, but
mm-hmm.
motions have to be discussed, go through all the stages of deliberation. On the other hand, you have, especially in parliamentary systems, clear party majorities,
mm-hmm.
Right from the beginning of
yeah.
the deliberation process. So the question is, what does deliberation actually do to the process if
mm-hmm.
majorities are clear and if they normally don't change
yeah.
during the process? So that was the puzzle, and therefore I found it interesting to study
mm-hmm.
the role of deliberation in this
yeah.
context.
Yeah, that is interesting. And as you say, there's an interesting tension there between, so representatives are representing their parties
mm-hmm.
and their voters, and
exactly.
they're voted on a certain platform, maybe
mm-hmm.
ideology,
mm-hmm.
with certain expectations,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
but then there's also, like you say, these procedures which seem to expect some deliberation taking place.
Yeah.
So does deliberation take place?
Yeah, I would say yes,
okay.
deliberation takes place, but it's important to keep in mind that there might not only be one form of deliberation
mm-hmm.
That is observable, and that was one of my assumptions, that deliberation is not only a theoretical concept
mm-hmm.
but a political practice
yeah.
That also varies according to the context in which it takes place or in which it is deployed. And so my task was to kind of reconstruct and trace the different forms or diverse forms of deliberation taking place and how it relates to other practices and what effects it might have in
yeah.
these diverse settings.
Yeah. Okay. So you looked at deliberation that happens in different settings, so like in the house, on the floor,
mm-hmm,
or
exactly.
in the committees, and
exactly.
in more informal settings?
Exactly.
And did you discover some important differences there?
Yeah.
Mm.
Good question. So there are a lot of important differences that might not seem to be so striking as to, at first sight, but if you go in a more deep analysis
mm-hmm.
and also also conducted interviews with members of parliament, studied minutes of meetings and so
mm-hmm.
on and so forth, you find out that these kind of formal and informal modes of deliberation are more or less complementary to each other.
Yeah.
And where formal deliberation often looks like a ritual that has to be done,
mm-hmm.
Informal deliberation that takes place maybe beyond formal settings of committee of law debates can also play an important role and can also have important effects.
Yeah.
You know?
Okay.
So and the effects might be that that positions are adjusted, that argumentations, justifications change over the course of deliberation, that arguments are anticipated by
mm-hmm.
by other parties during the process. So we can observe diverse effects that are only observable not directly, but rather indirectly, and also on the long term.
Okay. So did you observe members changing their minds through informal or formal deliberation? And did you observe proposals changing as a result of...
What you can observe in terms of changing proposals is, for example, an interesting mechanism that parties would not change their positions within the formal setting of a committee, for example.
No.
And of course, not in the floor debate either.
Mm-hmm.
But they would adjust their motions beforehand if they figure out that they, for example, missed some important argument or information.
Mm-hmm.
So if they are confronted with counter arguments, for example, by through the submission of a motion for change by the opposition, then the majority would maybe bring in a revised version of their own initial draft. So they would anticipate the situation of the formal encounter, but the adjustment would not happen during the encounter, but beforehand.
Interesting. So, in your opinion or on observation, were these adjustments always very minor or were they sometimes substantial?
Yeah. So the rule would be minor adjustments, I would say, the normal case. But you also have specific examples that whole positions are taken taken over by majorities if they find that, for example, a certain proposal by the oppositions is really good, they would, of course, reject it in a formal setting, but might nevertheless take it up 6 months or so later and bring it in as an own and slightly modified version. That's a typical practice that also happens. It's not, perhaps doesn't happen all the time, but it does happen.
Interesting.
So, and of course, you have probably also long-term learning effects.
What would you say are the main takeaways of this for sort of studies of deliberative democracy in the field?
Yeah, good question. So to study the parliamentary context is, I think, a very fruitful case also for learning how deliberation plays out in diverse contexts. Because the parliamentary context is a institutionally very diversified context, and you can learn a lot about the different roles and forms deliberation can take in play, and you can also draw conclusions for how would deliberation look like or could look like and what functions it could fulfill in a broader and larger deliberative system.
Okay, thank you very much, Andreas Schäfer.
Thank you.